thanks for coming out. Such a great group and exciting opportunity to hear a terrific lecture this afternoon. I'm Dr. Tommy Kidd. I'm the Associate Director of the Institute for Studies of Religion and also a professor of history. And if you don't know the Institute for Studies of Religion, we're an interdisciplinary institute on campus that sponsors the study of religion across many disciplines, including sociology of religion, philosophy of religion, religion and health, and obviously religious history, which brings us together today. So I just want to say on behalf of the Institute, thank you for coming. But to introduce our lecturer, I want to bring up my friend and colleague, Dr. David Whitford, who's a professor of Reformation Studies in the Religion Department.
Professor Dr. Hermann Selderhuis is the professor of church history at the Theological University of Apeldoorn, and is also the director of REFO 500 that you just watched the video about. REFO 500 connects people across the globe concerning issues around the interpretation and understanding of the Reformation as we approach the 500th anniversary of the posting of the 95 Theses in 2017. And so we are lucky to have him here today to talk to us about some of the continuing legacies and questions around the Reformation. Dr. Selderhuis.
Thanks for your welcome and for your introduction. When I heard the applause that you got when you got up, I think they're more happy that you are here than I'm here. But thanks for staying at least a while after Dr. Whitford has spoken. Here are the steps in the paper of this afternoon. So first a short introduction and then the basic question, why should we at all in 2017 commemorate the Reformation, then some options, complications, and programs. Then my general topic is post-Christianity in relation to this Jubilee, but since I know more about Europe than about North America, I will focus on Europe, and then the idea to get back to the sources and what do they teach us on this event, and then a conclusion. This is Frederick V, the Kurfürst, elector of the Palatinate. The doctrine on the debate on the Reformation Jubilee started already in 1617, so with the first anniversary. Frederick proposed the celebration of this 100th anniversary and wanted to do that in a common event of Lutherans and Calvinists. But he was made suspect by Lutherans, politicians and theologians of making this proposal for improper reasons. He was accused that his only motif to commemorate was political, namely to show that the Calvinists in the Palatinate did belong to Luther and his tradition, and therefore they were entitled to a legal place in the empire under the umbrella of the 1555 Peace Treaty of Augsburg that allowed only two groups, Catholics and Protestants were seen as Lutherans, or Lutherans were seen as Protestants and not Calvinists. Frederick, however, said in defense that he suggested the commemoration first and foremost to thank God for what he had given the German church in Martin Luther's rediscovery of the gospel. The lesser political reason was, in fact, so he said, a theological one, namely to demonstrate over against the Church of Rome and over against the Catholic emperor that the Protestants were, despite their internal disputes, a firm unity. Frederick, however, was not able to convince his fellow Protestants. So that means that in 1617, so the first Jubilee of the Reformation, the Calvinists and the Lutherans each had their own party. This episode makes clear that the questions as to why to do a commemoration of the anniversary of the Reformation, how to do it, and with whom to do it, are not new, mainly for different reasons, however. They are still highly relevant, even more so since things in Europe and in the world have changed quite a bit since Frederick's proposal. In fact, the position of Christianity in Europe has in the last 50 years changed more dramatically than in the almost 450 years between what is seen as the starting point of the Reformation in 1517 and the developments in church and society after World War II. Yet there seems to be a self-evidency, especially among Protestants, that the commemoration of the 500th anniversary of the announcement of Luther's 95 Theses will be celebrated, and many events also at this institution are being prepared for that. But the fundamental question as to how to do this, and even more why to do so, are seldom posed, let alone answered. I want in my presentation to deal with these questions and want to suggest some answers which are open for debate. I was told to stop about quarter after, so if I go over that, just yell and I'll stop so there can be some time for question and answers. So first, why? How, before the question as to how to commemorate the Reformation in post-Christian Europe, goes the question as to why should the 500th anniversary of the Reformation be commemorated at all. In all activities around the Jubilee of the Reformation, this quite fundamental question should be asked and answered first. You see here the marketplace of Wittenberg with 500 mini Luthers. They were for sale, 500 euros. Did you get one here in Bela? No? 500 euros a piece, and it was suggested that this was modern art, but it brought a lot of money, a lot of attention, but also a lot of critique, because people thought Luther was bigger than he is on these statues. So why would you celebrate something like this? Of course, if you are a German, I can imagine that you celebrate a national hero who helped shape your language and was so influential on your country's history. But what does such a jubilee mean to me when I live in Sao Paulo, in Nairobi, in Bologna, or in Waco? Before getting into these questions, the choice for the name commemoration must be accounted for. The word celebration has quite a bit of positivity in it, maybe too much to be useful in a setting that tries to be neutral. But on the other hand, the word commemoration can indicate that we are dealing with something purely historical, with something of the past, something not really relevant, something we look back at in order to just move on afterwards. Yet having to speak, to choose between the two, speaking about a commemoration deserves preference in order to deal with this jubilee as objectively as possible. So if you say celebration, then that's the critique in, for example, Germany. Then the Catholics say, well, we got nothing to celebrate. It is a fact, of course, in our history, but it's no reason to celebrate that. We can celebrate the death of Luther sometime, but not the beginning of the Reformation. The question as to why commemorate can and maybe should be answered from an elaborate philosophical analysis of the concept of commemoration. But this paper does not do that because I am not fit to do that. I just want to list a number of motifs for commemorations in general and specifically to the commemoration of this Reformation Jubilee. First, a historical motivation. Historical interest in who did what, why, and where can be a motif. This motif can drive scholars as well as others interested in history as such. The present identity of Europe has decisively been shaped by the religious developments set in motion by Luther. So the search for the causes, origins, actors, and consequences of this movement that essentially shaped a new Europe and influenced developments globally up until today is a self-evident motif to study 1517. Second is a theological motivation. Under the qualification theological, I subsume a variety of motifs. These can be ecumenical, in this sense that 1517 is on the agenda as a chance to bring back the unity of the Christian Church, at least partly, as it was lost over the Causa Lutheri. The theological motif can, however, also be the opposite. The Reformation Jubilee can be taken as a good occasion to show how wrong the reformers were, even some academics do it like this, how evil their position was, how disastrous their long-term influence remained. Or the other way around, that is, to justify Luther's action, revitalize his theology, demonstrate the rightness of a certain Protestant confessional position, and some even used this jubilee to once again demonstrate that the Bishop of Rome, how friendly he smiles, is still the Antichrist. Third is a ecumenical motivation. A third motif I mention are the economical aspects of a commemoration. Such jubilees can be big business for publishers, travel agents, cities, and museums that see a chance to boost the number of visitors and customers, and let's not forget, for the managers who nowadays run universities and send in their professors as writers and presenters to gather funding and to put their institution in the spotlight to increase enrollment. Fourth, a political motivation. There can also be political reasons today just as much as in the 16th century. Fortunately, we are away from the situation in which the Luther Jubilee in 1983 was used to promote socialism, or just as much to strengthen the Protestants in socialist countries. But for Europe at least, it does count that the 500th anniversary of the Reformation has a political dimension which is essential for Protestant minorities in Catholic countries. For more Protestant countries promoting their national inheritance, as well as for individual European nations or German federal states, taking this opportunity to show their independence and importance. At the same time, some wish to focus on the Reformation as a European event that can help strengthen the idea of a unified Europe, whereas just as many others blame Luther for having divided Europe. All these motifs are not new and have been there ever since special, or we should maybe say, ever since holy places, persons, and dates were celebrated. Although motivations may vary, the answer to the question as to why commemorate the Reformation is quite clear, as the Reformation was one of the most influential events in the history of the world and of the Christian Church, and without it, the present global society would look completely different. If we want to understand, that is my thesis, the world and the Church today, and if we want to take responsibility for the world and for the Church, we need to know about what happened in the 16th century, about the context of the Reformation, its actors, its message, and the reactions to it, and a commemoration can stimulate and improve such an understanding. In order to reach this understanding, all motifs mentioned should be considered, as each of them is a legitimate motif. But a commemoration will only be fruitful if these above mentioned motifs are combined, and if those working out of these motifs work in cooperation with each other, independent of the fact whether you are religious or not, independent of the fact whether you are a Lutheran or a Catholic, or even if you are, as Frederick V, a Calvinist. Now then, how to do it? Options and complications. There are a number of options. These options are closely related to the various motivations, but contain as many complications. The historical option, for example, can approach the Reformation as a movement, and Martin Luther, who is wrongfully identified as the Reformation, as a person from the past with no connection to the present. Luther might then show up as the monk who rocked the church, irritated Pope and Emperor, got married, drank a lot of beer, preached, got overweight, and died. This option places Luther, and with him the Reformation, in the past, makes him a man of yesterday, yet even long before yesterday, and presents him certainly not as a man with a message for today and tomorrow. In the theological approach, Luther can be instrumentalized as apostle of freedom, as a rebel against Rome, as father of tolerance, as inventor of grace, and more such idealizing qualifications. The economical option is the one in which Lutheran Reformation are sold, and where cities and regions are preparing for the expected millions of visitors coming to the places where Luther lived, where he stayed for at least one night, or which is also a chain of cities that call themselves the almost Luther cities. So cities where he intended to go, but he never got to go there. These approaches are now being undertaken, and scholars should not have the illusion that they can do much against it, but they can put something over against it, if they, to a certain extent, make use of the aforementioned motifs and approaches to get the attention they want for their academic approach. But all dealing with this commemoration, and especially those that tend to see this commemoration as a celebration, need to have the awareness that there are some serious complications about the Reformation that should not be ignored but openly dealt with. There is, to start with, much good to be said about Martin Luther as the key player in the Reformation, but he is as much a fascinating personality as a problematic one. Here's a well-known painting where the talks between Calvin on the left and the bishop in the middle and Luther are being painted, and there's an Anabaptist who tries to listen and hear what's going on in order to get unity. But Luther, for ecumenical purposes, is quite complicated. For if people would read what Luther says in his polemics about Jews, Catholics, Baptists, and about anyone else with whom he did not agree, and these were almost all people, then you have a problem. To be honest, it must be said that this is not just typical for Luther, because, for example, when you read Erasmus, the proclaimed father of tolerance, on Jews and on women, no one gets excited about that either. However, if it is stated that Luther is the discoverer of the gospel, of the authority of the word, and of the power of grace, the question is legitimate: how it is then possible that he can disqualify so many others in a quite often offensive and for certain not so Christian way. It must therefore be said that no scholar can deny that it is quite a challenge to link Luther in a positive way to political, social, or religious tolerance. I know that many Protestants would like it to be different from what the sources say, but whether the topic is Luther and the Jews, Calvin and Servetus, or Zwingli and the Anabaptist, there is hardly any hard evidence for the idea that the era of the Reformation and the age of tolerance are somewhat interdependent. Any attempt to present the Reformation as the initiator of tolerance and equal rights in order to demonstrate the importance of the Reformation is doomed to fail, for it just cannot be proven by historical facts. Also, when it comes to Luther as evangelist of freedom, this is restricted mainly to a freedom of sin and guilt, and not to freedom in a political sense. If it were for Luther, for example, my native tongue would be Spanish. For Luther said, just obey those Spanish occupiers and do not organize any resistance. Luckily for the Dutch, the Prince William of Orange, brought up as a Lutheran, turned Catholic and then went over to Calvinism, because there they had a theory of a right of resistance. That's why I talk Dutch, which is handy, because there are books that say that Dutch was spoken in paradise and will be spoken on a new earth again. So start learning it. Also, when it comes to theology, Luther can be problematic, which becomes clear to mention just one example from his attitude in the debate on the Lord's Supper, in which he claimed to be right in such a way that he not only held off any attempt to find peace with Zwingli and his team, but was also ready to accept conclusions on the person of Christ as a logical consequence of his position that were regarded by many of his colleague reformers as completely irrational. In short, Luther has too much in him that is against him, especially for people of today, that it would be a great mistake to put him on the scene as a hero or a saint. Commemoration can imply celebration if it's just a celebration, but then your eyes are wrongfully closed for another complicating fact, namely that the Reformation did mean a split in the church, did create a potential cause for religious wars and for other animosities, as well as that it caused for a personal tragedy in the lives of many men and women in the 16th century and after. It may be easy for a convinced Protestant to say with satisfaction, where would we be without the Reformation? Well, that question may not be as rhetoric as it seems, for some might answer with, the world would have been much better off. Protestants should be aware of this on the way to 2017. Myopia is one other complication. Luther started the whole thing. Or as Calvin more rightly said, I quote, the gospel started in Wittenberg, end of quote. Yet focus in and before 2017 should not be just on one man, but also on the many beside him, the many against him, and on the Reformation movement as a whole and all of its various aspects. To focus only on Luther in this commemoration makes the whole event vulnerable. All you need is a newspaper giving three quotations of Luther on Jews, women, and Turks to depict him as an intolerant fundamentalist having no message at all for today, except maybe this one, do keep away from me. An identification of Luther with the Reformation would in this case mean that such a negative presentation of Luther would result in an even negative presentation of the Reformation. The challenge also is not to look at the Reformation, but it's better to speak of the Reformations. So there's a Protestant, but there's also a Catholic, there's also an Anabaptist Reformation, there's a political Reformation, there's an educational Reformation, so it's a plural thing. Luther operated in a world in which many things changed and developed. As to religious matters, his act of Reformation was the cause for other confessional Reformations. However, Reformations of the 16th century can also be applied to Reformations in other fields of life. The 16th century did not only see a reformation of church, theology, and spirituality, but also one of understanding culture, of concepts of scholarship and academics, of education and politics, and through all of this, a great variety as to national and regional developments can be detected. These aspects, options, and complications have to be considered when dealing with the issue of commemorating 500 years of Reformation in a post-Christian society. Maybe a bigger challenge than the problematic side of Luther and his team is the notion in the second half of the question, how to work with that in post-Christian society, and I focus then on Europe. Now, what is post-Christian Europe? A mass of literature has been published on what this qualification means, and I am not an expert on this. Maybe I should take a course in the Institute for Religion to know more about that. But what I do know from the literature is that the situation on this term is quite complicated. Although numbers vary, the trend in most Western European countries is that people do not go to church anymore the way they did, and that there is a decline in the number of those saying to believe in a personal God. The decline in the number of churchgoers over the last four decades has resulted in a decline of the number of church members and will result in a consequent decline of the number of church buildings towards 2017, mainly in Western Europe. Yet, there is an essential question. Is the assumption that Europe is post-Christian true? There are other numbers that make clear that Europe is not as secularized or post-Christian as it seems. About half of all the Europeans pray or meditate at least once a week. 3 out of 4 Europeans say they are religious persons. The number of professing atheists is and stays low. In the southern countries of Europe, the Christian faith is alive and visible every day of the week. And I just got a mail from Dr. Jenkins on the Bible Belt in the Netherlands, which underlines the same approach. In Eastern Europe, churches are built. People return to the church. A growing number of children and adults are baptized in Eastern Europe. The falling down of the Berlin Wall as a symbol of the end of the divide between Eastern and Western Europe demonstrated the power of the church and its believers. It were the prayer meetings on Monday evening in Leipzig in September 1987 where this wall started to come down, and that in a socialist country where the church had in many respects been so reduced. And to name just one other remarkable fact, although Luther may not have been too happy with it, It is undeniable that the present Pope enjoys great popularity and is with positive headlines daily in the news more than any other Protestant in the world. There are many other arguments to conclude that, I quote, it is premature to speak of a post-Christian era. All of this should not move away from the fact that the situation is in many aspects fundamentally different from the situation in the 16th century, but also from the situation 30 or 40 years ago. Public life is less characterized by the Christian tradition, which is best illustrated by the way life on Sundays looked like, by the sight of growing number of mosques and of church buildings being converted into bookstores or apartments. Europe has moved away from a multi-confessional to a multi-religious society, and from public to private Christianity. On the other side, this means that being a Christian has become an option, not a given. You have to decide that you are a Christian, and that is what we see among many young people. They decide to be that. There is more a sense that I am a Christian in my town than the sense that I am a member of a church or something similar. It is a kind of believing without belonging, as well as an ecclesiastical mobility, in analogy with the development that people switch jobs, move to other places, and think more in terms of flexible relations than in divine obligations. Church and religion have been caught by what can be called the McDonaldization of society, in the sense that religion and the church seem to be more consumed as a fast food snack than as a home cooked dinner. In large parts of Europe, Christians have become eclectic, to put it positively, or to put it from another perspective. Many Christians are at a loss when it comes to what it means to be a Christian. This also has to do with the image of the church. The happy and popular present Pope cannot take away the incredible damage the cases of sexual abuse have done to the Roman Catholic Church. For many of the mainline Protestant churches in Europe, a similar image problem is a fact, since their changed position on marriage and sexuality and their tolerance towards theologians denying the most essential doctrines of the Christian faith has caused by members and by non-members the idea of a church that has grown away from its core business and has given up the position of a mother caring and guiding her children. And I think it is just at this point that the situation of European Christianity and maybe of the Christian church in general is similar to the situation of the church in the early 16th century. What Luther saw was a theology and a church that had moved away from its source, its foundation, and its message. The pre-Reformation laity experienced the church as distant, bureaucratic, obsessed with power and money, and the clergy as dumb and ethically lax. That is just how today many in Europe experience the church. Besides this religious déjà vu, the similarity of the situation counts on other matters as well. Economical instability, a distrust in politicians, disorientation of many young people, marital and familial issues are just a few of the items that also played in the 16th century. And on top of that similarity, one can at the same time say that Europe may then be labeled as post-Christian or secularized, yet there is a growing presence of religious issues and of religion. Because of time, I have to skip a part. A secularized Europe is also a religious Europe, is my thesis. I say religious, not Christian. Dietrich Bonhoeffer may have seen right when he predicted that Christianity would decline, but that religion would return. And it did return, if it was ever away. This means we have to focus on what the Reformation is all about. It was with great expectation that in 2011 the former Pope Benedict visited his homeland, Germany, which happened to be Luther's homeland as well. He carefully omitted going to Wittenberg and the Wartburg and chose instead to visit Erfurt as a town where Luther was still seen as a Catholic monk. However, it was expected that the Pope during this visit would say some kind words about Luther and would open up some ecumenical perspective. All who expected that were afterwards greatly in confusion, anger, and disappointment, since the Pope instead asked attention for Luther's message as dealing with a central theological question on the relation between the righteous God and sinful men. According to him, this question should again be asked today. So instead of lifting up the ban on Luther or any other such kind ecumenical gesture, the Pope asked the Protestants, do you guys still know what the Reformation was all about? Well, now, do Protestants need the Pope to tell them what the Reformation was? It does sometimes seem so. That is, since most Protestants do not or do no longer see the Pope as the Antichrist, but quite the opposite, see him as the last stronghold of Christian truth and values, and Rome as the last resort of a visible and powerful Christianity, many are convinced that the Pope will most likely be right in knowing what Luther's position was. Certainly, for the Protestant experts, it is clear what Luther meant and stood for. But for the wider Protestant audience, he's more often seen as the funny beer-drinking monk with only one single message: be merry, get married, for free grace will allow you everything. But what happens if we turn to what Luther wanted, preached, lived, and died for? Reformation research has profited immensely from the influx of social historians in what was seen as their area. For long, much of research has been dominated by historians of theology who mostly were focused more on theology than on history, and for that reason did not always pay attention to political, social, and intellectual contexts. It were social historians that taught these historians of theology and the church historians that there were other factors important than just theology, and that a description of institutions cannot be complete without a description of the people within these institutions. The more negative result of this forceful but healthy correction, however, was that for some social historians, the theological component in the Reformation became sometimes not only just one component among many, it also became a quantité négligeable. This was often communicated by scholars with great skills in history, but who had no clue at all about theology and the content of the Bible. After a while, a number means not all, but a number of church historians came back to their senses. Most of them had learned the lessons taught to them and eagerly started to bring these things back into balance. In brief, this balance can be put as such: the Reformation is a process in which many factors play a role, but amongst which the theological role is said by far not the only one, but yet the decisive one. Luther's primary goal was not a reformation of society, not a revolution in natural sciences, not a restructuring of political and social life in Europe, not a re-evaluation of marriage, family, and education. Luther's goal was not even a reformation of the church. Certainly, he was much concerned about the state of the clergy and the abuse of power of the church and in the church, but his main concern was the relation between God and man, and more specific, the relation between a holy God and a sinful man. When he writes in 1545, in his foreword to the first edition of his collected works, that it was as if the gate of paradise was opened to him when he discovered what justification really means, he mentions this as the key element in the Reformation. This is 1545, which means after he had seen what the Reformation all cost. That it was as if the gates to heaven opened, he does not mean that all of a sudden he saw that Europe needed a new political system, or that monks and nuns should get married, or that human beings need freedom for self-development, but it meant that he was convinced that all of a sudden he understood a central Bible passage in the right way, and that he found out that man can be saved from God's judgment and from eternal death by the free and undeserved grace of God. It is as simple as that. That this was for Luther the fundamental issue is best demonstrated in his debate with Erasmus, 1525. On the last page of his long reply to Erasmus' work on free will, Luther makes perfectly clear what, according to him, the Reformation is all about. I quote, "Therefore, then I give you great praise," he says to Erasmus, "and proclaim it that among all you are really, you are only the only one who got into what in fact is the true issue at stake here, which is the heart of the matter, and that you have wearied me not with those irrelevant issues about popery, purgatory, indulgences, and other trifles. For that's what they are, more than real issues. with which so far nearly all have troubled me, and I in vain must say, it is you, and only you, who has seen what was the point on which everything turns, and so you attack the main issue, and I want to thank you heartily for that. The heart of the matter, the point on which everything turns, as Luther calls it, is the topic of his discussion, and the topic is the question how sinful men can come to terms with a righteous and holy God. That message relates to issues of personal and institutional guilt, public justice, reconciliation, righteousness, ethics, which are all issues of today's. It is quite remarkable that in many novels, plays, and movies, the notion of guilt plays a role, where it may be asked if that issue is still a central notion in sermons, catechism, and Christian education. In Luther's Reformation, the issue of guilt played an essential role, and the Church could use the commemoration of the Reformation to pick up that issue again in order to show that the Church knows where the Christian message is about and to show that she knows what a secularized society is dealing with and that she can contribute positively to that. The same is true for the issue of ecology, which can be seen as a secularized form of eschatology in the sense that there is a fear that the earth can no longer bear the sins of a society of consumers and waste producers. Concern for the future of the earth and of human existence does relate to the theological notion of responsibility for creation, but also to eschatological expectations of which the Reformation was full. Once again, the commemoration of the Reformation should not be simplified to a song-like phrase as Luther is the answer for the world today, but if the Church is convinced that Luther's gospel is a message for all times, she could use the anniversary of Luther's gospel to address just that message to the world, and as a convenient extra, make use of the fact that the similarities between the times then and now may cause for at least listening to the answer former times gave to questions similar to the ones of today. In conclusion, a complicated relevant. Amidst all factors that play a role in the 16th century Reformations, the heart of the matter was Luther's new theology. And just as Luther and the Reformation demonstrated the power of faith in an unsurpassing way, there would not have been a Reformation, nor would there have been other Reformations without this central issue of justification. If this fundamental item, which Luther called justitia aliena, is ignored, not only is the Reformation misunderstood, but also the commemoration becomes meaningless, and gone is the topic in which the relevance of the Reformation can be demonstrated more than through any other topic. In closing, I want to point at some similarities, but I will leave that out. I got two more minutes. Okay, if you say so. Some similarities, just as a hint for making this 16th century event relevant for today. A first similarity may best be characterized by the German word Orientierungslosigkeit. So that you, what happened to me yesterday when your GPS loses the battery and you're somewhere in Texas and you find out that it's way bigger than the Netherlands. So where am I? And then you start speeding and you get caught by a policeman, who was nice. Many of the basic certainties in our society are either lost or questioned. And many, mainly young people, is my experience, are at a loss as to values. Sexuality is only one of them, and of the future. Second, just as in the 16th century, the question of religious tolerance is an issue. I don't know what the situation is in the United States, but in Europe it is a pressing issue day after day. Although then it was between two Christian confessions, now it is among a multi-religious society, but the political and social impact is just the same. Both eras face the possibilities, the challenges, and the dangers of a media revolution. The spread of the printing press combined with the increased possibilities of people to buy and read books is quite similar to the developments we see in digital data and social media. Fourth, economic issues vary from corruption and greed in the top of organizations to a growth of debts and poverty, then as well as now. Fifth, a merit-driven society in which many strive and only a few succeed can be noticed both then and now. Difference is that then we had saints who gained enough merit for us to enter heaven. Now we have the blessed sportsmen, sportswomen, movie stars, and CEOs that gain or gather enough to live on earth as in heaven. Six, the church-state relations are becoming increasingly an issue. The issue is evidently related to changes in society and in the position of the power of the church. Yet the question as to the responsibilities the state has for the church, the independence of the church towards new legislation, etc., was also an issue the Reformation placed on the agenda. Seventh, that sin and salvation were items people were preoccupied with in the 16th century is well known. But they are so just as much today, yet in a different sense and setting. Salvation has become this worldly, which is even true with the feel-good faith propagated by some Christian preachers. And although sin is no longer connected to death, let alone to eternal death, sin and guilt are the major problems for which people seek help by psychiatrists and therapists. Eight, the quest for spirituality and spiritual stability is also an interesting similarity. Tour operators and monasteries have discovered spiritual tourism and the need to escape stress and hectic as a niche in the market, whereas just as then, the church in its preaching does not seem to match with the answers people are looking for. Many do seek the church as a space to find inner stability and to reload. It is the space of the church that touches people, not so much the message of the church. John Calvin did not see Europe as Christian, nor did the other reformers see Europe as Christian. They did see that all Europeans were baptized, but only a small minority of them lived up to their baptism. They did see many churches, but also many empty spots in the church. They complained about Europeans not being Christian in the real sense at all. Calvin speaks about Europa afflicta, the oppressed Europe. And he can come to no other conclusion than that Christianity, Calvin says, 16th century, Christianity is worldwide near to collapse. Europe is in trouble. Maybe he would say the same if he would comment on Western society today. Maybe the reformers would say the same if they would see much of the church of today. Is Europe's church as much post-Christian as Europe's society? In the past 500 years, the Aufklärung has fundamentally changed the way the major Protestant churches saw the Bible and the Gospel. Have these changes been so fundamental that the gap between the Protestant churches today and the theology of the early Protestants is much wider than only 500 years? I do not believe so. The function of the church, as Luther said, churches are therefore there to do nothing else than have Jesus speak with us and have us answer to him with prayer and praise. That function of a church hasn't changed today. But what is being said and done in present-day Protestant church building, is that still in line with Luther's view? Therefore, it should be asked what a commemoration in 2017 should lead up to. Or to say it differently, what do we want to be left after the last bus has left Wittenberg on the day after, which is November 1st, which is All Saints? What should have entered the hearts and minds of all those in 2017 that have been flooded with Lutheriana in all shapes and sizes? The answer depends on your motivation. If we would want to stay with Luther motivation, the answer is quite clear. If Europe is post-Christian already, or if it's about to get there, then the commemoration of 500 years Reformation is one of the best things that can happen to Europe and maybe even to the world. Thank you for your attention.
We have just a few minutes for questions and answers. So does someone have a question? John.
If you have, Calvin said Europe is in trouble or Europe is a mess, and his solution was that the church has seen themselves as refugees, a refugee church, mm-hmm. Is that something that's a viable solution today for the church to see itself as that?
Well, see, his being a refugee was not an option. It was just something that happened to him and to many others. But what I do see in all these reformers is, like Martin Butcher in Strasbourg says, heaven is our fatherland, coelum nobis patrium est. And that means we should not stick too much to things of this world, and we should be ready to move if needed. So exile, and I think that is, we were just talking about that this morning. Dr. Jenkins said something about the Bible Belt in the Netherlands, where many people leave cities like Amsterdam and go live in places where, you know, traffic lights are switched on Saturday evening at 12, so you celebrate the Sunday. That is not exile, that is escape. That is not what Calvin wanted, because he kept sending out preachers to France and told people, stay there. But the notion that, well, like the song says, this world is not our home, and if we as Christians convey that to others, not preach it but live it also, then that could be help. Yes.
Anyone else? Yes, ma'am.
I think I cannot speak for your situation in North America, because I just come here, I speed through, paper.
Go through speed traps.
Yes. But I think for the European situation, it would be best just to go back to basics. So what is the message of the Bible? That's what, not to make him the ultimate example, but that's what Luther did. Let's go back to now. What is this all about? And then speak in plain language and show that the message is relevant for today. I think that is important. What I hear from young people, and I have a couple of them at home, they don't even mind a sermon of 45 minutes, as long as the message is clear. They do not want vague messages and things about politics and society, because they said, we had that in school. When I come to church, I want to hear something different. So back to basics, that would be my answer.
Would you join me in thanking Professor Selderhuis for visiting today?